Let's turn together in our copies of God's Word to Psalm 43 tonight. Psalm 43, all five verses. Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people. From the deceitful and unjust man, deliver me. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy, and I will praise you with a lyre, O God my God. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. So far, the reading from God's word this evening. May he add his blessing to our hearts. One of the things that is always striking when you read a book like Fox's Book of Martyrs or something along those lines, where you read the record of people who surrendered their lives for the sake of faithfulness to Christ, is that these normal people, the same kind of people like you and I are, would in their moment calmly have waited for the wild beast to devour them in the arena of Rome, or as we read about Mr. Cranmer this morning, that he would endure the burning of his body with such calmness that he would be able to surrender his body to the flames with full conviction of heart, with full commitment to Christ, without fear and without complaint. And as you read about these people, even though they're flawed and imperfect like we are, what you come to realize is that these people in their moment, when it was asked of them, recognize the truth of what this psalm is describing. They recognize the surpassing value of the promises of God, and that whatever the circumstances are that they might be facing, that God's promise to them supersedes any perception they might have about the present. They understood the freedom of the gospel as it's recorded in this psalm. And this psalm clearly lays out for us that God's deliverance of the godly from oppression unto salvation leads them to a praise, leads them to a thanksgiving that endures forever. And as we consider together this theme of this psalm, I want to look first at the vindication that is needed by the psalmist in verses 1 and 2. Then we want to look at the worship given by the psalmist in verses 3 and 4. And then the promise remembered in verse 5. So we want to consider God's deliverance of the godly from oppression unto salvation, which leads them to praise and thanksgiving that endures forever. And we want to look first at the vindication needed. We want to look next at the worship given. And then we want to look at the promise remembered. So let's begin by considering the vindication needed as it's laid out in this psalm. I trust that you would recognize it if you were with us last Lord's Day in the evening, that there is a close relationship between Psalm 43 and Psalm 42. Various reasons for saying that. One of the reasons that people say these psalms are closely related is because we have entered into a section of the songs of Korah. A lot of the psalms up to this point have been Davidic psalms. Psalm 42 was the first one that was a psalm of the sons of Korah. And all the way through to Psalm 49, you will see this in the heading, except for in one psalm, the 43rd psalm. It is without that superscript, that heading that we come to see in some of the other psalms. But that would be a fairly vague reason to say that Psalm 43 and Psalm 42 are closely related. Of course, the more obvious reason is that refrain that's borrowed or continued, whatever your view may be, from 42 to 43. So if you look at Psalm 42 and verse 5, why are you cast down, O my soul? That same refrain is repeated verbatim in verse 11. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Of Psalm 42, then skipping over to Psalm 43, you see that same refrain again. Verse 5 of Psalm 43, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? The relationship between these psalms seems to be so close that some people have suggested even that originally these two psalms were one psalm, that these actually were joined and separated at one point. The, the separation of the song into two psalms, whether that's true or not, of course, doesn't influence the meaning of the song. So it ought not to trouble us that people would say something like that. But whatever the case may be, there is a strong connection, whether they were the two psalms were one at one point, or whether they were written next to each other, so that they're borrowing themes from each other. The psalm is a psalm of an outcry for the rescue of the Lord. This is Psalm 43. The psalm seeks to establish a proper grounding for the reader. And what do I mean by that? Well, the psalmist is crying out to the Lord for vindication. You see that? To be vindicated, of course, is to be cleared from blame, to be cleared from suspicion. And the psalmist is crying out to God that he would accomplish this. Now, that has an implication. At some point, the psalmist has been accused of something, and he's been accused of something that he has not done. There are, of course, times where accusations are justified, where accusations are correct, and other times when they are not. And here it seems that the psalmist is an innocent victim of accusation. And you see that because he's asking for vindication in the first place, but you also see it by the nature of the people who are accusing him. It says in verse 1 that he needs vindication against an ungodly people, and he needs to be delivered from the deceitful and unjust man. Now, the first question that we have to answer as we work our way through this psalm is, who are the ungodly? Of course, it's easy for us to say the ungodly are the people not God's people. They're outside of the camp of God's people, but that's not always the case. Even as we saw in our reading tonight from Jeremiah 5, where the ungodly were identified as the people of Israel. And later on in Jeremiah's prophecy, the same thing is set before us in even a more poignant manner, a more shocking manner. It says there in Jeremiah 23:11, both prophet and priest are ungodly. Even in my house I have found their evil, declares the Lord. So you're looking at Jeremiah 23, verse 11, speaking of the prophets and priests of Israel, and it's identifying them as the ungodly. God is condemning the leaders of Israel. He's condemning these two offices, prophet and priest, and he's condemning them as those who are ungodly. Now, if you're thinking about an example from Scripture, we don't know if David is the writer of this psalm. We're assuming that it's the sons of Korah. But if you think of David's life in the Scriptures, if you were to think of the ungodly in David's life, you could see how the ungodly are present in David's life among the people of Israel. Some examples. Think of King Saul and his traveling to the witch of Endor to seek counsel from the witch of Endor rather than to rely on God. Think of Absalom, David's own son, who usurped the anointed one from God and captured the throne for himself. Think of Shimei, who, when David is chased out of Jerusalem, stands on the opposite hill, throwing dust and rocks on him and shouting curses upon his head. These are examples of the ungodly among the people of Israel. But in David's life, you could also see the ungodly outside of the people of God. So, for example, the Philistines, the age-old enemy of the people of Israel. These were ungodly people who captured the ark, not in David's time, but they captured the ark. They brought it to their own God's temples, and they were afflicted because of it. They were not living under the authority of God. They were living in hostility to God. Now, in what sense are the ungodly to be understood in this psalm? It seems likely to me, especially if we remember the connection to Psalm 42, that the psalmist here is writing of the ungodly as they are resident among the people of Israel. He's speaking of the ungodly among the church, for example. You see in verse 6 from Psalm 42 that the psalmist is writing from the land of Jordan, Mount Hermon, Mount Mizar. These are all territories within the boundaries of Israel. So he's writing from within the boundaries of Israel, and he's appealing to God about the ungodly that he finds around himself. whoever the enemies are, whether they are in the church or outside the church, doesn't really affect the meaning of the Psalms all that much. But what you have is these enemies who are gloating over the oppressed man of God. The basic description then of the ungodly, whether they're in Israel or whether they're abroad, is a group of people or an individual who is not concerned with the honor of God, not concerned with the worship of God, but rather concerned with his own glory or being absent from God. He's not interested in following the Lord's commandments. Now, that's important because God gives his law to man to be a guide for him unto godliness, that they would learn to walk in a way that honors the Lord. And so here, when it deals with man's relationship with each other, when it deals with how we're to love our neighbor, which would be the situation between the psalmist and the people who are accusing him, when you're dealing with that, you're dealing with the second table of the law. Now, when I talk about the second table of the law, I'm talking about commandments 5 through 10, beginning with you shall honor your father and your mother, all the way through to you shall not covet. And so that means that for the ungodly, the second table of the law is ignored in relation to the righteous. They don't recognize God's authority structure, for example, in the fifth commandment. They can yield to anger in a selfish way. They have a desire to destroy and they have a desire to damage. But in verse 1 of this psalm, the nature of the ungodliness is specified towards the ninth commandment exactly. So it's speaking there of a man, an ungodly people who are deceitful and unjust in their dealing with him. Now, if we turn to our confessional statements, we look at the shorter catechism and the shorter catechism as it's addressing what is required in the ninth commandment. It says there that in obeying the ninth commandment, there is a requirement to maintain and promote the truth between man and man and of our own and our neighbor's good name. So when you're dealing with deceit, the ungodly is neither promoting the truth, nor is he concerned with the reputation of his brother. Now, we see this problem working itself out in our own day, don't we? I mean, I think this is at the very essence the rot that sits at the foundation of the core of our political system. Because politicians of all sorts of stripes are not necessarily concerned with making a case that's related to the truth. What they're concerned about is making a case that convinces the most people. The truthfulness of the matter seems to be of secondary importance for many, not for all, but for many. And so the ungodly, they're not concerned with truth. And so it's important that we know what is true. We need to know and examine whether or not the statements that are made are true, whether they regard a person's reputation, whether they regard a specific policy, whether they regard a specific way of governing. And this is what we see in our political realm. But we also see the labors of the ungodly in the Christian world. You see it especially what we would call the blogosphere now, right? As people write articles about other people and feel the need to post them publicly. These can be articles that are highly critical of people. And perhaps these articles are posted online and gossip spreads and slander is made against a Christian man, against a leader, or against a group of leaders within the church. And the intent of the ungodly in those particular moments is deceitfulness. It's to conceal the truth, not to promote the truth. Maybe they fabricate the whole story. Maybe they make the whole thing up. Maybe they take part of the truth and they present it as the whole truth. Or maybe they tell the whole truth, but they tell it for the destruction of the person that they're writing about. This is the bad motive of the ungodly. He's seeking to deceive. But not only is the ungodly seeking to deceive, it says in verse 1, that the ungodly people are also unjust in how they behave towards the psalmist. Their actions are not based on what's morally right. Their actions are not based on what's morally fair. And there is a description of the unjust in Proverbs chapter 29. Proverbs 29, verse 27, the last verse of that chapter says, "An unjust man is an abomination to the righteous, but one whose way is straight is an abomination to the wicked." So, the unjust is an abomination to the righteous and vice versa. A righteous man is an abomination to an unjust man. There is no concern for truth, of course, and injustice. There is simply a perversion of the truth, even to the extent that it would be established in the court of law. Maybe the person who is unjust in this particular case would make an appeal to feelings, would make an appeal to procedure, would make an appeal to seniority or to advice given by somebody else to excuse their own ungodliness. This is not the pursuit of truth. This is the pursuit of injustice. Maybe false witness is born to accuse an innocent person of wrongdoing, as was done to our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. You remember in Luke 23, when the religious leaders are done with him, They bring him to Pontius Pilate. And when they bring him to Pontius Pilate, what do they say about him? They say, "This man was inciting revolt and was telling the people not to pay their taxes." Now, from Luke's gospel, we know that's the opposite of what Jesus said. But the people, the religious leaders of that day, not concerned with truth, not concerned with establishing what is accurate and true, were instead seeking to defame Christ, that he would be slain, that injustice would be done to him, because their concern was not with truth, their concern was with their own way, their concern was with their own desires. And at the start of this psalm, Psalm 43, the psalmist is asking the Lord to vindicate him, to protect him, to defend him, to deliver him from the causes of the people such as we have described just now. He knows that God is the only place for safety when he's dealing with the deceit and the injustice of man. He knows that God is the only place of safety. And when he looks at the results of his trust, he's discouraged. You see that in verse 2. When he turns to God and he says that he takes refuge in him, he looks at what he sees around him and he says, "But why? Why? Why have you rejected me, Lord? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of my enemy?" The psalmist thinks, or it seems to the psalmist, that God has rejected him, that in a sense the ungodly have won, that their deceit has accomplished its purposes, that the injustice has ruined him. The enemy, the ungodly, continues to oppress. It continues to break the psalmist to the point that in verse 2, you see that he is going about in mourning. He's in tears. He goes about mourning all the day long. It's happening to the psalmist as it happened to Hannah, Samuel's mother, when Peninnah tormented her because she was barren. And she was in tears as she prayed to the Lord her God. As it happened to Joseph, as he cried out to his brothers from the pit. As it happened to Job, as he was helped by his good friends who came and told him, "What have you done to the Lord to have this happen to you?" And his question to the Lord is, "Oh Lord God, why have you rejected me?" He is in need of vindication. He is in need of rescue. But when he looks around, it doesn't seem like it's coming. Now, we want to continue that our study in the psalm by considering the worship that's given by the psalmist as it begins in verse 3 and 4. Now, the question, "God, why have you rejected me?" can be asked respectfully and it can be asked disrespectfully. In essence, the psalmist is saying to God, "God, where are you? Where are you?" Now, you can say that two different ways, right? You can say, "God, where are you?" or "God, where are you?" Right? In the psalmist's case, it's like he's trapped in a smoky room. And he's crying out, "Where are you? Shout your voice out so that I can hear you, so that I might find where you are." That's what the psalmist is doing. It's not an accusation against the Lord, but it's a cry that he would see where God is so that he would go to him. He would find his comfort and his rest in him, that he would be secure in him. It seems to the psalmist like God is absent, but he knows that that's just the fog, and he wants to know where God can be found. And so his request, as he gropes around in the darkness of his circumstances, as he's overwhelmed by the deceit of his enemies and the injustice of the ungodly, he says to God, "Oh Lord God, send out your light and your truth and let them lead me." You have a psalmist beset by deceit, beset by lies. This is darkness. And so he asks for the opposite. He asks for God's truth, that would be light to him. He is suffering injustice and he's asking God to give him light, that he would be led by God himself. Now these requests, they're so important because the temptation of man, of course, is to respond in the flesh, to prove your point, to make your case. But the psalmist is content to rest in God's protection. He wants to be present with the Lord, which is represented in our psalm here by the temple, by the holy hill. Verse 3, "Bring me to your holy hill, then I will go to the altar." These are the places of worship for God. Now, when the ark, not the ark, when the temple is finally built and the ark is brought into the temple, Solomon blesses the temple and he prays a prayer of dedication over the temple. And as Solomon is praying this prayer over this glorious temple that they have just built, Solomon prays that prayer with a full acknowledgement that God cannot be contained by the walls of this temple. You see that in chapter 8 of 1 Kings, the 27th verse, where in Solomon's prayer he says this. He says, "But will God indeed dwell on earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built?" So why would the psalmist appeal to the temple, a place where God cannot be contained? Well, it's explained for us a little later in Solomon's prayer when he uses the temple as the representation of the presence of God among the people of Israel. And he continues his prayers. As people pray to the temple, he prays that God's eyes might be opened towards this house, the place of which you have said, "My name shall be there." This is the place that God chose in the cultic worship of Israel to represent his presence among his people. And that's what the psalmist is appealing to here as he deals with the deceit and the injustice of the ungodly. God cannot be constrained to earth, but the temple is the place where his name dwells. The temple is the place that represents God's presence. So what the psalmist is longing for is to be present with God's people. Isn't that the theme that showed up in Psalm 42? When in Psalm 42, verse 2 and 4, he remembers with longing the time when he led the people of God in procession to corporate worship. And this is what the psalmist is asking for here too, to be part of the worship of God's people in God's house where God's presence is represented. And when that happens, when he goes to the altar of God, when he is brought to the holy hill of Israel, what is his reaction? Verse 4. He says God is his joy. Not just his joy, God is his exceeding joy. And it says that he will praise him with the lyre. This is not a mumbling of a hymn at the end of a service. This is a full-throated, enthusiastic worship of God, heart, soul, mind, strength, in prayer, in praise, in worship. All of it to God's glory. This is what the psalmist is talking about. Exceeding joy. Praise with music. This is the delight of the writer of this psalm. But in verse 3 and 4, we might come under the mistaken impression that the joy that belongs to the Christian is somehow conditional. If I will be in the presence of God, then I will have joy and praise the Lord. But here comes that chorus, that refrain, that we described it as a bungee cord for the Christian last Lord's Day, right? When you're heading down the and you're committing yourself to despair, this promise of God pulls you back. Right, this promise, why are you cast down, O my soul? We saw it in Psalm 42 twice, where the psalmist would recount how badly his circumstances are. And he was giving himself into despair. And just when he was about to lose sight, he was in the smoke-filled room and he wasn't seeking the name of the Lord. All of a sudden, this promise, it comes back to his mind. Why are you cast down, O my soul? In essence, he's saying to himself, what are you doing? How can you forget about the promises of God? So the refrain, the chorus, it's that bungee cord that snaps the psalmist back from his despair. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? He's pulling back from the brink of despair, and he's comforting himself with the promise of God. And he's saying to himself, if God is my hope, if God is my salvation, the deceit, the injustice of the ungodly cannot harm me. They cannot do what they hope to accomplish. Now, in the short term, perhaps his reputation was sullied. In the short term, perhaps people whispered about him. But the goal of the Christian is not the favor of man. The goal of the Christian is to be in the presence of God to worship. This is the goal of the Christian. This is the comfort of the Christian. That God, the praise of God, it's not a conditional thing for us. Thanks be to the certainty of Christ's redemption. We come to God with a certainty that those circumstances may be hard in the moment, that at one point there will be eternal joy. That's what the psalmist has said earlier in Psalm 30 and in verse 5. His anger is but for a moment, his favor is a lifetime. And this well-known verse, weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. This is the life of the Christian. Our calling is to please God, not man. And so the praise of God isn't conditional. That's why the psalmist in the refrain says with certainty, I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. He doesn't say, I might praise him. If things work out better for me, then I'm going to be exceedingly joyful. I will again praise him. It's like the song of Job, and when Job is in the midst of all that agony, in Job 19, that in the midst of all this agony, I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end, I will see him again. Loose paraphrase, right? This is the life of the believer, to know with certainty the promise of God. To not look at the opinion of man, but to strive after the worship of God. Because God is always with his people. It doesn't matter how things look. He is always present with you. In a sense, and we saw part of this morning as we consider the work of Christ, the work of Christ is this very complaint, isn't it? He was brought up on false charges, deceit and injustice. He was accused of being an insurrectionist, deceit and injustice. He was convicted, although he was sinless and completely innocent under the law, another instance of injustice. And in all of that, he remained completely silent. Now, what makes us think that as Christ's disciples, we will fare any better? As Christ suffers, so we should expect to suffer. As the ungodly treated Christ with deceit and injustice, so will they do to his disciples. Now, what's good news about that? Why would you sign up for a religion like that? Where's the gospel in all of it? Well, the gospel is that Christ's enemies do not triumph over him. In the moment, their deceit, their injustice seems to have accomplished the work. They hang him on the cross and he surrenders his spirit, and they puncture his side with the spear, and the water and the blood rushes out, and they take him down from the cross and they put him in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, and they roll that stone across and he stays in it for 3 days. But then the good news comes. That tomb is rolled away. And the resurrection is accomplished in all its certainty. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Do we not know the end? We know the end. We know who wins. We know what happens to to Christ. And all the people who thought they were so clever with deceit and with injustice, Jesus will return one day. And they will stand before him, and he will judge them for their sinful actions. Now that is the gospel, Christian. Vindication is certainly yours. So that means as God's people, we have to learn to trust God to defend us. Maybe you've experienced the kind of treatment that this psalmist has experienced. Perhaps you have had people speak ill of you. Perhaps people have deceived others about you. And that can be a crushing thing. It can reduce you to tears. But there is the power of God. In those moments, you can look at this psalm and you can remember Christ your rock. How are the righteous vindicated? Through the promise and power of God. Now, of course, there may be a time to defend yourself. But even as you're going through that process of defending yourself, your hope is never in the strength of your presentation. Your hope is never in the cleverness of your words. When you come to defend yourself, your hope is only in the power and righteousness of Christ. When the godless seem to win through deceit and injustice, you know that you will be vindicated. Why? Because your hope is in God. Because of the work of Christ. Because when the dead are raised, you will be raised up in glory as well, acknowledged as the very Son of God, and acquitted because of the blood of Christ. There's only one who accomplishes this. The one who accomplishes it is the one who's described as the salvation and God of the psalmist. This is the work of Christ in the life of the psalmist. So as you grow in your ability to trust God to defend you, there is a corresponding praise that should come to God from your lips. God's deliverance, God's salvation should lead you to exceeding joy, should lead you to songs of joy, praise from the lips of the believer unto the God who saved him. Now, how do we practice this as God's people? We practice it, for example, in prayer. Our prayer should include many thanksgivings. Our prayer should find ways to acknowledge the ways that God has protected and preserved us, how he's defended our cause, how he has delivered us from the deceitful and unjust man. This response to the work of God in our hearts is also the reason for hearty singing amongst the people of God. Now, I recognize, trust me, I recognize there are differences in abilities when it comes to singing, right? You think you sing great until you hear a recording of yourself, and then you realize, ooh, this is not so nice. But that doesn't mean that our singing isn't hearty. That doesn't mean that our singing isn't as joyful as we can make it to the glory and honor and praise of God. Even if all you can have it be described as is a joyful noise, that is a privilege of the Christian to sing praise unto the Lord. This is the reason for hearty singing in the church of God. These are expressions of joy, exceeding joy, to the praise of God. We can also praise God for his presence with us in our conversation by telling our children of the work of Christ in our own lives. When blessings come, to acknowledge them as coming from God's hand. When we are rescued and when God provides for us in certain ways, to acknowledge this is from God's hand, children. Let's never forget it. When oppressions come, we can articulate a trust in God, to thank him for his refining work in us. We can praise God by refraining from grumbling against the things that he brings into our lives. Those are manifestations of the exceeding joy of the believer. To remind ourselves of the certainty of the promise of our salvation. These also are expressions of exceeding joy. These are expressions of the praise of God in man. And then we can also praise God for his presence with us, even in our thinking. The things that we think about express our joy about God. So when your mind gives way to the agony of the moment, when the waves of your circumstances begin to crash over you, and you can feel yourself letting go, to turn to this psalm and to say to yourself, even in your mind, so that nobody can hear it, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God. This is the acknowledgement in our own minds of the exceeding joy that we have in Christ, of the praise that flows from our heart towards God, for Christ. This is how we turn to God. This is the strength of our conviction with regard to our salvation, which causes us to live every day in exceeding joy and in thanksgiving to God. This short psalm reminds us of the promise that God has made. This promise is true no matter the appearance of things. Christ has come. He has purchased deliverance for His people, and therefore His promise is sure. It's not mostly sure. It's not sure on good days. It's not sure when we got a promotion and when everything's going well. It's sure all the time. The promise of God never fails. And so that's why when we come to God in hope, we come to God in an eternal hope. From oppression unto salvation, a salvation that is eternal. And this is the greatest gift that ever has been given to anyone. It is greater than the approval of man. It is greater than the accumulation of riches. It is greater than success. It is greater than anything else. And when we realize how great this gift is, and when we realize the certainty of this gift as it's recorded in Psalm, it should lead each of us to praise and thank God always, not mumbling, but with exceeding joy and with praise to Him. Let's pray together.